tune in tonight. Those who are listening by means of YouTube and Facebook, welcome to Pine Grove Baptist Church here in Rockingham. Tonight we have a special treat for you. Brother Jerry Watkins will be coming to share what God has laid on his heart. He's one of the adult teachers here at Pine Grove, and he's always challenged my heart, and I look forward tonight to hear what the Lord has laid on his heart. So, Jerry, if you will come on up and say what's on your heart.
Thank you, Pastor Carl. It's always an honor to be able to stand and stand up and teach from the Word of God. You know, the Bible is our user manual. It's among one of the greatest gifts that God has given to mankind. It shows us how to have a fulfilling life, and it prepares us for our God-given purpose. In modern terms, we may call it our GPS. God's Word is our spiritual GPS. If we want to stay on track, move in the right direction, and avoid making wrong turns and stay on track, then it's important that we study God's Word. If you'll turn in your Bible to Romans chapter 8. Tonight, I want us to look at a question that we Christians ask sometimes, and that's, why me, Lord? This is one of the first questions that we often ask ourselves when tragedy strikes. Tragedies fill our news today. This virus, the pandemic, all this that dominates our headlines in the newspapers and on the television. And so with all these tragedies happening worldwide and even in our personal lives, we find ourselves asking the question, why? Why is this happening? Is God punishing us? Why is all this bad stuff happening? How are we supposed to interpret these events? You know, there are many occasions that could qualify for the title of personal tragedies. The doctor says it's cancer. A loved one suffers from the effects of Alzheimer's and are beginning to lose their mind. A stroke takes our freedom away. Parkinson's disease causes us to lose control of our body. A child is born dead or dies too soon. An accident leaves us disabled. A hurricane, a flood, a tornado, maybe a fire wipes out our home. Maybe it's the loss of a job. Maybe it's trouble in a relationship. It's in times like this that one of the first questions we asked is, why me? What have I done to bring this into my life? I go to church. I work in the church. I pay my tithe. I read and study the Bible. I pray. Why me, Lord? Let's look at what Paul says in Romans chapter 8. And I'm going to begin with verse 18. It says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willing, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, the wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why does he yet hope for? But if we hope for that which we see not, then do we wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is in the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. There's so much going on in our world today that we don't understand. It seems like there's trouble all around us, and things are getting worse every day. We know that you're in control of everything. And so as we study your word tonight, help us, Lord, to understand that whatever happens, we know that we're safe in the arms of Jesus. Amen. You know, if we live long enough, sooner or later, we will encounter circumstances that are really hard to understand. At least from a biblical point of view. Somewhere along the way, I think we have become convinced that life should go our way all the time. As Christians, we may believe that God will protect us from every tragedy, large or small. God is good, and because we are Christians, you know, life should be fair, but life is not fair. We learn that lesson early in life, and about the time we forget it, we are reminded with another painful lesson that hurts us. So again, we asked, why me, Lord? Sometimes we feel like the pain that we have is just too unbearable. That it's gotten too steep, too rocky. Maybe it just seems way too long, and we just feel like we can't hold up any longer. We get the feeling that we cannot handle it anymore, and we're weighed down, way down. So what keeps us going in those moments? Jesus is the answer. While physical pain in those, physical pain can be, it can just be overwhelming. But it's not the most important thing in life. Jesus is. Experiencing financial loss can be devastating. But it's not all that matters. Jesus is. The death or loss of a loved one leaves an unbearable vacuum in our days and nights, but Jesus is still there. When we ask, why me, we make our circumstances more important than Jesus. We forget that life is temporary and eternity is life with Jesus. Our hurts make us overlook that fact. The fact that this life is really just a preparation and heaven is the payoff. Now there are four ways that most people use when they're facing suffering and difficulties. And the first one is denial. When someone is in denial, they won't admit the truth. Even when they know that, and they know that you know that, we'll say, how are you doing? and they'll say, great, I'm doing great. We know that they're not telling the truth. We're all like that occasionally. There's something in all of us that makes us pretend that everything is going okay, even when it's not. We pretend the problem is not there, or we pretend that it's not as bad as it really is. And the second way many people deal with suffering and difficulties is they get angry. Sometimes we react to tragedy by getting bitter, and sometimes even shaking our fist at God. When we don't deal with our anger constructively, it affects every relationship we have in our life, including our relationship with God. It's impossible to go through life angry at others and maintain a warm and a positive relationship with God. We cannot hate our neighbor and love God at the same time. Some believers live that way for years, and then they wonder why God seems so distant away and why their prayers are so empty and why their Christian experience is lifeless. We need to take a good look inside, because we'll never get better until we deal with that anger that's within us. And then the third way some people deal with suffering and difficulties is they blame others. That's a very popular option. We all use it sooner or later. It's easy to blame others for the things that happen to us. A lot of times it's the people that's closest to us. Sometimes we even blame God. A pastor was working with a couple that was getting a divorce. He asked them the question, what's the problem? He said it's her fault. She said it's his fault. It's easy to blame others for the troubles that we're having. And then the fourth and the best way that we can deal with suffering and difficulties is to accept it and learn from it. We can deny it. We can get angry. We can blame someone else, or we can accept what happens to us, and we can begin to learn from it. Of those four ways, only the last one is truly the Christian way of dealing with the difficulties of life. When trouble comes, we really only have two choices. Either we can become a victim, or we can become a student. How much better it is to be a student than a victim. Being a student means asking yourself, what have I learned from this? What is God trying to say to me? How can I grow from this painful experience? Now, having said that, I have to admit that there's many questions that I can't answer about why bad things happen to God's people. Sometimes I believe the reasons are obvious. More often they're obscure. If I had all the time in the world, I still couldn't answer all the questions about suffering, because some of them, they simply defy any human explanation. But what I want to do is call our attention to one of the central passages in the New Testament about the issue of the believer and their suffering. Now, the New Testament contains a number of helpful passages on this subject. But this one in Romans chapter 8, I believe, is one of the most important. We find in this scripture, I believe, a liberating perspective. It will lift us up. All of us need to learn. We need to learn what God is saying in this passage of scripture. Now, the theme of this scripture is given to us there in verse 18. It says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Underline those words, sufferings and glory. Paul here invites us to make a comparison of those two things. Most of us only see our sufferings. We're very much aware of the bad things that happens to us. All of us know what difficulty is all about. But you know, there's another side. There's the glory side. There's the suffering, and then there's the glory. If we could put all the difficulties of our life on one side of the scale, and all the glory that will someday be revealed to us on the other side of the scale, the glory side would be so much heavier than our present sufferings. In fact, I believe it'd be so much that we'd be amazed at what God has prepared for us. The sufferings of this life, even though they're terrible, they are not even worthy of comparing. When we compare them to the greatness of the glory that will be revealed to us. You know, if we could ever let that thought get a hold of us, that what God has for us is so much greater than what we're going through right now, I believe it would revolutionize the way that we look at our problems. With that as a background, I want us to consider three unchanging truths regarding suffering. I believe that these truths will help us. It'll help us have the right Christian attitude towards our sufferings. And truth number one is our sufferings are temporary. Look at verses 19 through 22. You know, we live in a frustrating world, don't we? Nothing works the way it's supposed to. You buy something and it breaks. You fix it, it works for a while, and then it breaks again. Eventually, it wears out completely, and you have to replace it. That's what Paul means when he says there in verse 20, the creature was made subject to vanity. Now, that word creature refers to the whole creation of this world, as stated in verse 22. In other words, the creation is subject to frustration. Nothing lasts forever. Nothing works right. And if you want to think about it this way, we live in a universe of Murphy's Law. But it's not just creation. It's also you and me. We don't work right. Children are sometimes born with horrible defects. We get cancer or some other disease. If we live long enough, we may have a stroke or a heart attack. And sometimes we may end up in a nursing home. That's ahead for all of us. And there's no escape for any of us. Unless we happen to be in the wrong place at the wrong time and get shot and killed. And the way the world is today, you never know. Verse 21 there speaks of bondage of corruption. We live in a decaying, frustrating world. We read about these storms and tornadoes and famines and earthquakes. We read about famine and starvation in many parts of the world. Something has gone wrong with the world. This is not the world that God meant it to be. This is a world that's full of pain, suffering, and death. This is a world that has been messed up and just knocked out of kilter. And it's all because of sin in the world. We live in a sin-cursed world. It doesn't matter how rich you are or how poor you are. It doesn't matter whether you have the most power in the world. You may be the most powerful person in the world. It doesn't matter if you're the president of the United States. If you live long enough, you will know pain. You will know heartache. And if you live long enough, you'll brush away the tears as death comes to your door. We live in a frustrating world, a world filled with pain and suffering and death. So from the Christian point of view, on our suffering, we can say, yes, it's bad, but it's not going to last forever. Yes, it's terrible, but this isn't the final story. This isn't the last chapter. Yes, we'll suffer, but God has ordained that our suffering be temporary. Something better for us is on the way. Thank God our suffering is only temporary. Truth number two is our suffering is educational. Look at verses 23 and 24. Paul says, we groan inwardly. We may groan because of a job we hate. We may groan because of unfulfilled dreams. We may groan because our bodies break down. We groan because our marriages break up. We groan because our children go astray. We groan because our friends disappoint us. Why does God allow such groaning among His children? Why doesn't He do something about it? Doesn't He know what we're going through? Doesn't He care? Sometimes we begin to question God's character, as if somehow He enjoys seeing His children suffer. We imagine Him laughing up in heaven as we weep, but it's not so. He knows what we're going through. He cares about our suffering. He feels our pain. The Bible says God allows our pain for a purpose. Verses 24 and 25 tell us that through our suffering, God wants to develop two qualities in us, and that is hope and patience. Hope is that settled confidence that looks to the future, knowing that God will someday keep all His promises. Patience is the ability to endure present hardships because we have hope in the future. Our suffering is educational in that it teaches us hope and patience. Two qualities that can't be gained any other way. We only hope for that which we don't have. If we have it, we don't have to hope for it. So if we don't have it, then hope teaches us to wait patiently for it. What is it that we're waiting for? Paul calls it our adoption, the redemption of our bodies, there in verse 23. We're waiting for the day when our bodies will be redeemed, when we can turn this old model in. Right now, in this age, we are children of God, but we're living in decaying bodies. You can't tell it by the outside who we are on the inside. We look like everyone else. We get sick. Our bodies decay. We finally die. But because we are related to Jesus Christ, we will someday be given a body like His, incorruptible, undying. We don't have it yet, but we are eagerly waiting for that day to come. And there's coming a day when our body won't need changing. We won't grow old and we won't get cancer. Jesus Christ will give us a brand new body. Until then, we live in hope, waiting patiently for that day to come. That perspective explains so much that happens to us. You see, God is weaning us away from putting our hope in the things of this world, so that our hope will be in Him alone. And the only way that He can wean us away from the things of the world is through suffering and difficulty. He brings us to the place where we must say, Lord, it's You and You alone. He's teaching us to wait on God right now. Right now, we're trying to scheme our way into a better situation. But eventually, we will say, Lord, if it takes forever, go ahead. Take Your time, because my hope is in You. Truth number three is our suffering is beneficial. Look at verses 26 and 27. It may sound strange to say that our suffering can somehow be beneficial to us. Some would say it even sounds unchristian. How can cancer be beneficial? How can the loss of a job be beneficial? How can a broken marriage be beneficial? How can public humiliation be beneficial? How can tears at midnight be beneficial? Suffering reveals our weakness. It strips away the mask of self-sufficiency, and it reveals our utter helplessness. It forces us to confront our own inabilities. It makes us say, I'm not as strong as I thought I was. I'm not invincible. Verse 26 says, there the Spirit helps us in our infirmities. That word translated helpeth means to come to the aid of someone in desperate need. Paul tells us, and I really like this, Paul tells us that the Spirit intercedes for us with groans. The Holy Spirit prays for us. Think about this. The Holy Spirit, who is the third member of the Trinity, prays to the Father, who is the first member of the Trinity. The Holy Spirit prays in the name of the Son, the second member of the Trinity, prays for us in our moment of weakness. It's God praying to God on behalf of God's children. What an amazing thought that is. How many times have you ever been to the point where you just didn't know what to pray? You didn't know how to pray. You come to the place where you just say, oh God, help me. Sometimes, you know, the more you care about something, the harder it is to pray for it. The reason we can pray easily for others is that we're not that deeply invested in them. It's easy to pray for people we don't know. But the more you care, the harder it is to pray. When it comes to those things in our life that really, really matters, your husband, your wife, your children, those things are hard sometimes to pray for because they're close to our heart. And Paul is telling us here that in our weakness, when we feel desperate about the things that truly matter to us, and we don't know what to say, and all we can do is cry out, oh God. The message is, don't worry. That's enough, because there's someone inside of us who is praying for us. We know that Jesus is up in heaven praying for us. But Paul goes a step further beyond that. When we come to the moment of complete exhaustion and can no longer find the words to say, we don't have to worry. The Holy Spirit will pray for us. In our weakness, He is strong. When we can't speak, He speaks for us. When we stand against the wall of depression, crying out to God, when we whisper, God, I just don't know what to say. I don't know how to pray about this. The Holy Spirit comes alongside and says, don't worry, I'll pray for you. In closing, we can read about two men in the Bible who certainly had the right to ask the question, why me, Lord? And that was Job and Joseph. Now, Job was a man that feared God. He had a high and a holy concept of God. And as a result, he hated evil. He had a wonderful family of 10 children. He was a very wealthy man. His family lived in luxury and ease. He had camels for transportation. He had many sheep, camels, oxen, donkeys, and servants. He was a very wealthy man. You know, Job is an important biblical example of a man who was materially and spiritually wealthy. He possessed many things, but they didn't possess him. Job had a proper perspective of material things. In the first two chapters of Job, God permitted circumstances that severely tested his faith. While Job didn't renounce God throughout his ordeal, he did raise that question, why me, Lord? Job lost a lot. He lost his family, his fortune, his health, his friends. When these events occurred in Job's life, he was faced with certain temptations. These are the same temptations that we all face when trouble comes. And Job, you know, he could have adopted his wife's attitude. She told him in Job chapter 2, verse 9, she said, then said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die. But you know what? Instead, Job worshiped God. Job finally saw that this thing was bigger than him. It finally dawned on him that all the things that happened was not because of any sins that he did or any kind of his sins, and not because of all the things that he was accused of by his friends. But he came to understand that all this happened for the glory of God. You know, if we could ever get a handle on that, it would help us greatly. Paul says in 1 Corinthians that whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do it all to the glory of God. In the end, God gave him twice as much. We're told that Job and his wife had 10 more children. When facing trials in life, it may seem like all is lost. But you know, we serve a God who is able to restore. And He will. He will always provide for those who belong to Him. And it reminds us of another person, a similar person, and that was Joseph. Here was a man that was beaten up by his brothers. He was sold into slavery. He makes the best of a bad situation. And then he's convicted of a rape that he never committed. Finally, Joseph was placed in the number two position in all of Egypt. Because of his position, he saves his family, he saved the nation of Israel, and he's reconciled to his father and his brothers, and all seems right with the world. But then his father dies, and the brothers get scared. They are concerned that Joseph has the perfect opportunity to get even with them. But in the course of their discussion, Joseph says these incredible words in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. He said, "But as for you, ye thought it evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive." Joseph understood. We must never forget, and that is, God is in control. There's nothing that he can't keep from happening, and there's nothing that he can't make happen if he wants to. So Joseph understood. He understood what we must never forget, and that is, God is in control. And then we find the answer in verse 28 as to why these painful things come. Look at verse 28. "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose." That's a great verse, isn't it? In times of tragedy, God is at work for good, even though we may not be able to see it. Finally, let me leave you with three thoughts. First of all, God's love is enduring, regardless of what we might face as we go through life. Nothing we face is able to come between us and the love of God. His love will endure through anything that comes our way. We should not get caught up in the things that happen to us and feel like that God has forsaken us, because he loves us, and he promised us that he will always be with us to the end. His promise is that nothing, absolutely nothing, will be able to come between us and the Lord Jesus Christ. Regardless of what happens in life, nothing that man can do to us can come between us and what we have in Jesus Christ. His love is enduring. It endures all and makes us secure. Second, God's love is enabling. Paul tells us that through all things, we are overwhelming conquerors. We are super conquerors when we face the battles of life. Why? Because he lives within us and enables us to stand. You see, the genuine believer proves that they are real by the life that they live. If the things of this world can come between us and living for God, then we're probably not saved to begin with. If a professing Christian can walk away from the things of God and live in persistent sin, that person did not lose their salvation. They just never received it in the first place. True Bible salvation will produce endurance in the child of God. The true child of God is enabled by the love of God to carry on until God calls them home to glory. When we are able to weather the storms of conflict, the storms of affliction, and turmoil and persecution, and we want to live for Jesus, you know what? That's a good sign. That's a good sign that we got the real thing. When everything that comes along takes you off course, you better do a checkup. And last, God's love is everlasting. Listen to what Paul says there in verses 38 and 39. "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Paul closes this chapter by speaking of the confidence in his own security and also in that of the redeemed. He tells us that there's nothing from the beginning of our life with God until the end of our life here on this earth that will ever be able to separate us from our salvation, that the salvation that we enjoy in Jesus Christ. And the end result of all of this is the blessed assurance that in Jesus we are forever protected and secure, come what may, in life or death. Now, if you're listening tonight, you may not even know what I'm talking about. But you know what? God loves you. He wants to have a personal relationship with you. And you can do that by putting your faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. The Bible says that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The Bible says that if we confess our sins and ask God to forgive us, and believe in our heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, He will save us and give us eternal life. It's the best decision you'll ever make. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that Your Word tells us that there's absolutely nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Sometimes we don't understand why things happen, and we asked, why me? So help us, Lord, to remember that whatever happens, in the end, You work it out for good. Give us a good night tonight and a good day tomorrow. And we give You all the praise and the glory. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.